Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. Welcome to 2024. And welcome to the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, Warner Brothers 1945. We'll be discussing Saratoga Trunk and Danger Signal. Once that conversation is concluded, please do stay tuned for Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We've got one more entry to discuss from the Ernst Lubitsch retrospective, December 2023. At the TIFF Cinematheque. It's going to be designed for living, so you won't want to miss that. First, let's take a look at the people under contract at Warner Brothers in 1945. This is, as always, drawn from Joel W. Findler's trusty chart, which can be found in The Hollywood Story, coffee table book from the 1980s.
But only in particular editions.
Only the first edition.
Because people got mad about the charts? Because they're so subjective?
The stars are given ratings of 1, 2, or 3 stars. Completely subjective on the part of Joel W. Findler. Sometimes we can see the reasoning behind it, other times not. Also very hard to determine why people are left off. Ida Lupino, 2 stars. Paul Henri, 2 stars. Barbara Stanwyck, 2 stars. Betty Davis, 3 stars. Peter Lorre, 1 star. Sidney Greenstreet, 1 star. Eleanor Parker, 2 stars. Humphrey Bogart, 3 stars. Joan Crawford, 3 stars. Lauren Bacall, 2 stars. Errol Flynn, 3 stars. Anne Sheridan, 2 stars. Jane Wyman, 2 stars. Finally, John Garfield, 3 stars. And now before we turn our attention to the films themselves, let's look at Clive Hirshhorn's The Warner Brothers Story. This is one of the few of these coffee table books that has a write-up that explains where, in Hirshhorn's view, the studio was in this particular year. So I'll read that first, and then we'll go into his overview of Saratoga Trunk. 1945, Mildred Pierce, Christmas in Connecticut, Pride of the Marines, God is My Co-Pilot, Objective Burma, To Have and Have Not, The Corn is Green, and Roughly Speaking were among the company's 19 feature releases that helped it to show a net profit of $9,901,563 for the year, a healthy improvement on the previous year. Mildred Pierce was nominated for the Best Picture Academy Award, but lost to The Lost Weekend from Paramount, although Joan Crawford, as Mildred, picked up the Oscar for Best Actress. Both Eve Arden and Anne Blythe were also nominated for Mildred Pierce in the Best Supporting Actress category, and Joan Loring was nominated in the same category for The Corn is Green. The winner, however, was Anne Revere for National Velvet, made by MGM. A Warner two-reeler called Star in the Night won an Oscar for the Best Short Subject, while the Best Documentary Short Subject was voted by the Academy to be Hitler Lives? Question mark. The Pride of the Marines was on the New York Times 10 Best list. I guess that implies that Mildred Pierce wasn't. And finally, the write-up on Saratoga Trunk itself. Though elaborately mounted, Saratoga Trunk, based on Edna Ferber's novel, was a major artistic disappointment. Its credits were fine, both in front of and behind the cameras, but someone forgot to give the film the kiss of life. Ferber's probing story about the illegitimate Creole daughter, Ingrid Bergman, of a New Orleans aristocrat who returns from Paris in the 1890s, takes up with a gambler, played by Gary Cooper, and sets out to avenge the treatment suffered by her mother at the hands of her wealthy family, never took fire. Slow-moving and long, the film runs 135 minutes, and with Bergman and Cooper respectively miscast and wooden, the film also suffered from Sam Wood's turgid direction. Casey Robinson wrote the screenplay, failing completely to extract the essence or the drama of the Ferber novel. It was produced by Hal B. Wallace, with a cast that also included Flora Robson, Jerry Austin, Florence Bates, Kurt Bois, John Abbott, and John Warburton. However, despite the film's failings, the marquee value of Cooper and Bergman was potent enough to bring in American and Canadian rentals of over $4.5 million. So that's the upshot of this. It was a huge success, this movie.
Clive Hirshhorn is what a rabid Edna Ferber fan who has to defend her against this film. It fails completely.
Well, he just doesn't like the movie in general.
It would seem so.
Now, I haven't read Saratoga Trunk. I've never read Edna Ferber at all. She is on my list of people to explore.
Hard for one such as I to understand this now. She was a best-selling author and also a member of the Algonquin Round Table, and that she could write these sort of epic American historical novels and also co-write Dinner at Eight, the play. It's very strange to contemplate.
Maybe right at the start, we should mention very important demerit, huge glaring problem with this movie. Flora Robson, cast as a black woman, pretty awful.
There's no reason. The production notes in the Wikipedia entries say that Ethel Waters and Lena Horne were considered for the role, so why did Flora Robson have to put on blackface?
No, she didn't.
What the hell?
Indefensible.
Is this Sam Wood? The conservative Sam Wood coming out?
No, I don't think so.
Well, why is Warner Brothers doing this of all studios?
I really don't know. I would like to know. There must be something on this in the annals of film literature.
Only that it was weird. I mean, from what I could find lightly searching on the internet, the footnote here is to the life and career of Ethel Waters. Maybe that biography from 2011 goes into the whys and wherefores, or maybe they don't know either.
Having Ethel Waters in that part would be incredible. Flora Robson's a good actress. Just don't cast her in this role. It's too late. They did it. Can't allow that to pass. However, I did like the movie as a whole.
I liked it too. I was kind of shocked that I've never heard anybody discuss this movie ever. I guess it doesn't have much of a reputation.
I avoided it when I was a kid. That's one of the times I did listen to Moulton. He gave it like 1.5 stars.
Maybe it was worth that just for the anachronistic blackface.
Yeah, but that's not why he condemned it. Let's hear the Moulton, just for a little extra context on why I skipped this when it showed up on PBS in the 1980s.
And why I guess I've never heard of it before now. I mean, vaguely the title sounds familiar, but I've never had a film buff recommend it to me.
So yeah, he does give it 1.5 stars out of a possible 4. I mean, that's really damning from Moulton. Elaborate but miscast, an overlong version of Edna Ferber's novel of New Orleans vixen, Bergman, and cowboy Cooper. Unbearable at times. Made in 1943.
Well, I guess, yeah, you could think it's unbearable at times if you're talking about blackface scenes. I mean, she's in practically every scene.
He doesn't say anything about that.
Do you think it could have anything to do with the fact that so few black actresses were considered marketable?
No, there's no reason for it. Ethel Waters could have played that role.
I just mean if they were unavailable, the few that were considered marketable in 1943 when this movie was made. I have no idea.
No, they didn't need a marketable star.
Even if you couldn't get a major black star, there's Teresa Harris. Wasn't she the companion to Marlene Dietrich in Flame of New Orleans?
Yeah.
Which was a major enough role, similar in screen time to this role.
Well, she's got huge roles in the Jack Benny movies too, because she plays the love interest for Rochester, and they have a real storyline in Loveline Neighbor and Buck Benny Rides Again.
Here's the thing. Granting this political sin, the fact that Flora Robson doesn't look like a real person lends an air of theatricality that really works for the style, which is an incredible style, at the beginning of this film. I don't know if Moulton is really capable of understanding. Well, you're not making me a fan of Moulton reading these things, these little blurbs of his. I don't know if he's capable of understanding artifice and stylization if it's not in an already approved classic. Maybe that's what he means by unbearable. Or to give him credit, if he were here to argue back with me, maybe he'd just say, yes, I understand artifice and stylization, I just think it's shit in this movie, which fair enough. But I thought the stylistic extremes to which it goes in the first 3 quarters, really, but particularly maybe the first third of the movie, which is very Orson Welles-esque, and also for that reason reminiscent of Sternberg, Berg, the treatment of Flora Robson's servant character, caretaker, although she objects to being called Mammy by Gary Cooper because she is a free woman.
Yeah, well, that's a huge... I mean, imagine maybe that scene right there is the problem. They can't have a black woman making an empowered speech like that if it's really a black actress. It might have been just too much for the world at that time. Or Warner Brothers was afraid it was.
I don't know, maybe.
But she basically says, fuck off. Don't call me that.
True, but you could always then just cut the speech and cast it appropriately, although that would be unfortunate.
It's certainly damning of Warner Brothers. It's damning of the entire political culture at the time, but if that was something they were concerned about.
To get back to what I was saying about the style of the film, her character paired with the Cupidon, the character played by Jerry Austin, who is a little person, and stylistic extremes of Ingrid Bergman's performance at the beginning of the movie, they're treated initially by the movie as a band of grotesques. And I mean that in the Orson Welles or Flannery O'Connor Southern Gothic meaning of the term, not just a bunch of weird people, but specifically a certain type of black humor caricature.
Ingrid Bergman in this movie, she comes across as almost grotesquely beautiful, right? It's like an offense to the world that anyone could look that good.
Apparently this was initially purchased by Warner's as a vehicle for Casey Robinson and Betty Davis.
Yeah, I don't think that would have worked.
Obviously, Betty Davis could play a sexually fascinating woman in the 1930s.
Yeah, but not this way.
No, they'd have to take out the references to her being an incomparable beauty.
Yeah.
And have her play other aspects of the character. The daring stylization of the performances, of the editing, camera movements, camera angles, the whole visual style. And we've commented before when we did the King's Row episode on how Wellesian the cinematography in that film was. Well, here the whole style seems to be nodding to Wells.
Sure, well, it was in the air. We're just right on the heels of Citizen Kane and Magnificent Ambersons when the movie was made.
But when people nod to Wells, they usually don't do it this way. They usually don't try to be this Baroque. And it doesn't work for Wells commercially, and well, it worked fine commercially for this movie, but not critically.
Even gigantic box office success did not solidify this movie's reputation. The critics, almost uniformly, everything I looked at, everyone hates it.
Weirdly enough, the article on TCM says that this was only a mediocre success at the box office.
If you look at the top box office hits, Saratoga Trunk is in the top 10.
Well, Wikipedia says it was the most lucrative Warner Brothers film of 1946.
Yeah.
For some reason, the article says the film was a modest commercial success. Was 1946 a terrible year for movies then, or they're just wrong?
I think they're just wrong. It brought in a huge amount of money. Maybe it cost so much that it didn't make a huge profit. I'm not sure about that.
It cost around $3 million and made almost $8
million. Yeah, okay. Well, that's pretty good.
According to, again, Wikipedia.
A critical bomb anyway.
Yeah, and it didn't clean up at the Oscars as Warner Brothers was hoping. I mean, it didn't do anything at the Oscars.
No.
Apparently, what does it say here in this same article on TCM? Many saw the film's single Oscar nomination, a Best Supporting Actress nod for Flora Robson, as a sympathy vote for her willingness to wear a thick shellac of brown makeup and absurdly heavy brows that gave her a permanently grumpy expression while playing the mulatto Angelique. Well, I'm not sure she deserves awards for the willingness to do this.
Awful. They should have given a Best Supporting Actress nomination to Florence Bates. She was amazing in this movie.
She was. Whoever Jerry Austin is was very good as well. This movie starts out presenting these characters as grotesques, but by the end, and that includes Gary Cooper's character when he joins the melee, by the end they've formed this sort of sentimental family unit that appears to... So spoilers, I'm going to talk about the ending now, leaping ahead to the ending. I thought that this was all heading toward a tragedy where Bergman's character was going to discover that Cooper, at least, was dead. So all of her plotting and plans, like, it's her tragedy. And she's finally at the point where she's going to marry the rich man like she wants to, and then she discovers Cooper's dead, and she destroys her chances at this marriage, and everything is ruined for her, everything she's wanted, and the man she loves is dead, and I thought it was going to be a tragedy. And then I thought maybe that this happy ending with this family unit, as described, was tacked on by Hollywood, but no, apparently that is in the novel.
Good.
Of course, the final scene, hopefully, is not in the novel, and is atrocious. absolutely atrocious, where the characters have to be put back in their gendered boxes, Cooper's and Bergman's, but apparently, again, according to this TCM article, and it makes sense, Bergman really wanted to play this role, but there was concern that it would hurt her star persona to play such a wicked woman. So presumably that ending was tacked on to protect Bergman's star persona.
Well, possibly, but even the way it's shot and played, it's undercutting itself as it goes along. She's just making this vow as kind of a prayer to snap him out of his delirium.
But it's a degradation ritual regardless.
Well, it is, but I don't think that a normal person leaves this film thinking, okay, well, Gary Cooper's gonna wear the pants and make all the decisions for them for the rest of their lives together. No.
I don't know what normal person thought about these Hollywood endings that seek to correct in a minute and a half an entire movie where all conventions and supposed values, mores, are just thrown out the window.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know how normal people reacted to that. Did they probe very deeply? Did these movies affect their unconscious? Did these endings actually make them feel comfortable with what had gone before? Did the fact that they felt comfortable with it, in fact, allow those challenges to convention to affect them? I don't know. I don't know. We don't have these classical Hollywood audiences hooked up to brain probes so that we can understand all of this. We only know what the movies were trying to do and how, even within that, writers and directors and performers might try to subvert what they were trying to do.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think that last scene is played with tongue far enough in cheek and far from the kind of passion and conviction that we had seen in earlier scenes. I don't think this is the final word on their relationship.
No, but it's the final word of the movie.
I really want to read this novel. There's so much of interest in the storyline, and it is a long movie, but clearly they're cutting out a lot.
So Ingrid Bergman is a genius.
She's amazing in this movie. I don't understand any negative judgments of her performance.
I feel like Jennifer Jones would have been good in this too, but let's not worry about that because Ingrid Bergman is fantastic. Gary Cooper isn't wooden?
No.
That was Hirshhorn saying that?
Yeah.
Does he not have eyes? Has he no eyes? Can he not feel? If you prick him, does he not bleed? On the contrary, he's understated compared to the insanity of Bergman's character. Like, the literal insanity. She does seem to be insane. She might be bipolar.
Well, she has some severe breakdown. It is unbearable, that first scene, but unbearable in a great way. I mean, it makes you incredibly uncomfortable, not with the filmmaking technique being applied, but with the situation and the human drama you're watching. Her freak out, seeing the chair or the sofa. Yeah, it's hard to know what to make of it when you're watching it for the first time, but that's good. That's what the movie wants. It wants to unsettle you, and it does.
I think I got a new respect for Bergman when I saw her in Ingmar Bergman's Autumn Sonata, because she is playing a very unpleasant character. It's fully up to the Bergman-style expressionist dramatics, and this is certainly a role also calling for her to do some expressionist acting, though in a very different way.
I mean, I think this is a better acting opportunity for her than Gaslight.
Oh, for sure.
Which won her an Oscar.
Well, no, because Cooper is very restrained. He gets very good performances out of actors, but always in a very restrained and classical style, not in this baroque insanity.
And certainly Sam Wood had some good practice with a character like this in King's Row.
Right, so King's Row is a very gothic film, right? Dealing with extreme emotions.
People could watch that and see Cassandra's outbursts and just check out of the movie, I suppose, but I don't.
That movie is well regarded, though.
It is.
But here he is doing something, again, it's surprising to me that it would alienate critics, but not the audience.
Yeah, this is a case where the public may have known better than their betters.
Well, something that the public presumably did take away from this film is that the stars have a lot of sexual chemistry. It's a very, very sexual movie.
It is. They had been paired earlier. I guess it was made the same year, but released much earlier, For Whom the Bell Tolls.
Right. So what's our story, Dave?
It begins as a kind of multi-generational revenge tale, but it gets sidetracked by this chance encounter with Gary Cooper's character, the Texan. He's a gambler. He's been hanging out on riverboats. quotes, but now he's going to go for a bigger game at Saratoga, which is in upstate New York. He tells her about how it's a playground for millionaires.
But let's get into the background of Cleo's character here, though. What is this multi-generational revenge saga?
Her mother was
in a kind of civil union with Bergman's father, who was an aristocrat. The mother was not?
Not marriage material.
She seems to have come from a line of courtesans, was presumably mixed race to some degree.
Movie hedges its bets on that.
They had this daughter, but then he had to marry a woman from his class. His family was putting pressure on him, I guess. Ultimately, the story goes, according to what Bergman heard from her mother, was that the mother was going to commit suicide and the father intervened and got shot and killed. And after that, they lived in Paris.
Well, they were hounded out of Louisiana, right, and out of the United States entirely, but supported by this Dulaine family who just doesn't want her coming anywhere near their sphere of influence.
We gather that she has spent her entire life just hearing stories of New Orleans and the wrongs that this mother has suffered.
Right.
Until her revenge, and not just revenge, but sort of public recuperation posthumously, becomes this daughter's life goal.
Yeah, so the mother dies, and as soon as the mother dies, or soon after the mother dies, Cleo gets together enough money, comes across the Atlantic, prepared to confront the Dulaines. And all of that happens in the first third of the movie. They declare a kind of truce. She is going to leave New Orleans, but her mother gets the public esteem of a monumental burial, and she gets a good amount of cash as seed money. She's already heard about Saratoga, so she sets forth. She's also heard about a mama's boy up there, millionaire.
Well, she's heard about that from Gary Cooper.
Exactly. It's so crazy.
So they developed this kind of sadomasochistic on both sides relationship.
Well, he says he's not the marrying kind. She is definitely the marrying kind, but she only wants to marry a millionaire as an extension of her plan to avenge herself on all respectable society.
Sure, which is a familiar movie, novel situation. But what's interesting here, I mean, for one thing, the movie makes it clear that they are drawn together by sexual desire. It's so patently illustrated for us by Sam Wood.
Sam Wood doesn't pull any punches in that regard. The movie also shows us that they are really well suited to each other. They help each other in all kinds of ways. Like, their temperaments are certainly radically different, but they work really well as a unit. Ultimately, it's a story of how they come to understand that.
Cooper's character is very phlegmatic. Bergman's character is very mercurial and fiery.
I mean, he calms her down.
But she riles him up.
Yeah, and he needs it, right? That's the point of the movie. He becomes the millionaire she needs.
He makes a speech early on about how where he comes from, there are either women are either good or bad. So he can't make this woman out who is acting in this terribly wicked way and in a very sexual way, but who at the same time seems sympathetic and vulnerable.
And he doesn't treat her ever like a tramp. He doesn't really have a Madonna whore complex. At that point, he's just in love with her, but it doesn't help him because she's got these other plans.
I was trying to evaluate what was going on with them throughout this whole first part of the movie until he goes to Saratoga. And I do think that she would have married him if that is the offer he had been willing to make. I do think she loves him enough for that.
It doesn't seem like it to me.
Well, she's certainly in love with him.
Yeah, but she's still got other plans.
I do think he has some reservations about marrying this woman who's clearly insane. Like, quite apart from the fact that she wants to marry a millionaire. Like, this trauma seems to have brought her to the point where she possibly does have a mood disorder of some kind, but it's also driving her to this kind of vengeful plotting that he does hate.
Yeah.
And that's warping her character, right? So I think he has reservations about that, and he's therefore not pursuing the marriage line as much as she would need if she were to be convinced to marry him despite the fact that she loves him. We should not whitewash the fact that both of these characters are extremely, extremely unpleasant people. Cooper is always, in very colorful ways, threatening to kill everybody, including her, and that whole scene that leads to this speech that Flora Robson's character makes about how she's a free woman and won't be called Mammy if they're going to be friends. He's threatening to gut her like a fish,
yeah.
and remove her spine, and he means it. Now, Cooper's far from being wooden. Cooper actually has as many notes in his performance in this movie as Bergman does. They're just more subdued. Because I believe him when he says that, just as I believe Clark Gable. Because Clark Gable's always saying shit like that. he can switch from that to warmth and tenderness very quickly.
Yeah, he's certainly ready to be affable whenever the opportunity arises. But if he perceives that there's someone against him, yeah, he could switch to death threats or just murder.
Exactly.
He's killed people, he says.
So these are both characters with a very dark side. He's afraid of hers, though, and she is not afraid of his or anything else. But she is afraid of ending up poorer, of not making something of herself, of having her plans derailed.
To carry off her plan, she has to pose as a European aristocrat, which the gullible folks at Saratoga are mostly willing to just lap up and believe. The millionaire picked out for her by Gary Cooper, it's kind of like a dare, right, in the letter?
Yeah.
It's like he's using this mama's boy millionaire to lure her there and just see what she does.
Well, his very unflattering letter, she accurately interprets as, yes, him luring her to Saratoga to be with him, but also, yeah, creating this dare situation.
Yeah, so you say you want to marry a millionaire, there's a real easy mark. I'll name him. Why don't you come and get him? Why don't you show me what you're gonna do?
Of course, he's not such an easy mark. First of all, because he has a fierce dragon mother guarding him. But then also he turns out to not be the type that we and Bergman have been led to expect at all.
No, that's the big reveal at the end. This guy knows exactly who she is and just excites him even more.
Well, this guy is like a cold-blooded reptile villain who could just as easily be played by Henry Daniels. The fact that he's played by a very affable-seeming actor, John Ward, Warburton, makes it all the better. His villainy is not given away.
No, not at all, not at all. You're feeling a little sorry for him most of the way. Even though, at the end, he reveals that he's been on top of the fake countess situation from the beginning. He also reveals that it's not like all these things that are being done to protect his poor little railroad were totally outside of his ken. He was expecting something like this. He's always waiting for henchmen to step in and take the bait and do all the muscle work for him, and that's what Cooper does, and almost gets himself killed in the process. All that stuff about the Saratoga Trunk, I've seen this movie title many times in the book title, but I never really thought about what it meant. And what it is a trunk railroad, so a short branch of a railroad that happens to be owned by Warburton, and has now become very important because it's going to connect up Albany with a rapidly developing industrial Midwest, like Pittsburgh and Ohio, right? People who are even richer than Warburton have been taking it away from him and manipulating New York politics. Probably Pinkerton agents are being used. Capitalists were big on those kinds of tactics at the time. And Cooper's Texas ruffian agrees to step in, and he gathers up a gang of his own thugs, including Cupidon.
Well, reluctantly, yeah. Including.
And they go to war, basically, over control of this railroad. And this is all happening in the 1890s.
So Cupidon has a whole arc.
He does.
Where he is tired of being treated as basically the servant of not just Bergman, but Bergman's servant. He doesn't like hanging around women all the time. Between that and his stature being regarded as less than a man. So as soon as Cooper comes into the picture, a real man, he attaches himself to him and wants this to be his new best friend.
Yeah, he starts trying to talk like a Texan.
And initially, this is, you know, played for comedy, and it seems like Cooper isn't interested. But, and this is again credit to the flexibility of Cooper's persona, right? That you believe the development of a real friendship between these two, although you kind of, it's happening the whole way along in the film and right in front of your eyes, and yet you don't really believe it until it becomes an important part of the climax.
Yeah, it's skillfully intertwined. It becomes very poignant.
So like everybody else, Cupidon is vicious as fuck. He actually fights very well. He's picked this up on the streets of Paris and New Orleans, I guess. Well, who knows what his life was before he became a servant. He's holding his own, but Cooper, because he feels protective toward his friend, once he sees him in the fray of battle, he's distracted. And then they're both taken down.
They both get hit in the head with a shovel.
And it's just absolutely brutal and awful.
These are not fun Western barroom brawl scenes. This is full out industrial warfare.
And Bergman is like always going crazy on her servant Angelique's ass too.
Yeah.
And threatening to beat her and having to be put in her place and remember that this woman has been a second mother to her, right? And is her best friend and guide. But another friend and guide offers herself in the Saratoga portion of the movie.
The great Florence Bates.
Florence Bates is just all over the place in 1940s movies, just popping up all of the time. I feel like we just saw her in 10 movies.
Heaven Can Wait, getting an express trip to hell from the devil.
And she's always, in every single movie, she's implicitly or more often explicitly the butt of all kinds of humor about how ugly she is. And this movie is no exception.
Do you know about her backstory?
No. This is the best role I've ever seen her in, because usually she is just playing a grotesque and here she gets to be a human being.
No, it was a revelation. And it made me think back about how much I've always liked her. This should have been an Oscar nomination. I really do believe that. So I'm really just going from the bio on Letterboxd here. But it's quite interesting. She was born in 1888. So that means she's about 55 at the time this movie was filmed. Her path to becoming an actress had many turns. She had a degree in mathematics, taught school until she married, then became the first Texas female lawyer. Then she became a bilingual radio commentator. After her husband lost her fortune, she and her husband opened a bakery in Los Angeles. In the mid-1930s, Bates auditioned for and won the role of Miss Bates in a Pasadena Playhouse adaptation of Jane Austen's Emma. When she decided to continue working with the theater group, she changed her professional name to that of the first character she played on stage. In 1939, she was introduced to Alfred Hitchcock, and he cast her in her first major screen role, the vain dowager Mrs. Van Hopper in Rebecca.
It's a very good black comic performance.
Basically, she just was working absolutely every minute of her life for the next 13 years until she died.
Like I said, she's just in every movie in the 1940s.
Yep. So she initially seems like she's going to be a problem for Ingrid Bergman. She's asking probing questions. Cupidon is kind of afraid of her. He knows something's up with her. And we figure, okay, well, she's going to be maybe an ally of Warburton's mom, or she's going to come into play on that side.
No, it turns out that she is in another faction.
Her own faction.
She explains this all to Bergman and explains that she wields the most power because she has no money, but she has an old name and she can make anything fashionable and she doesn't even understand why. So yes, she delivers this whole long speech that ought to murder any actress, but no, she makes it very compelling.
No, it makes me think she deserved an Oscar nomination. So that is a tour de force. She had offered up this big money proposition to Bergman. We'll help each other. Bergman eventually says, no, I don't want to do that. And Florence Bates just says, well, I like you anyway. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna back you up. This conversation was so fun.
I definitely wanted at least another half hour of this movie. I really wanted to see this duo in action.
I agree. Yeah.
I was so disappointed when that storyline was aborted.
They couldn't do it all, but they certainly gave us some tantalizing hints. Maybe there's a lot more of this in the book. Cooper has been living the gambler's life, and up at Saratoga, he's been betting on the races, but he's been taking careful note of the politicking around these different railroads, and particularly the Saratoga Trunk. He's the one that informs Ingrid Bergman about all of the parameters of that, but then she spurs him along as well by speaking out of turn in various places to great effect and putting his name on the map. He doesn't get the opportunity he gets at that poker table without her crazy interventions, right? Just barging right up to the richest man in the state, the enemy of Warburton. Casey Robinson, not knowing at all what's in the book, I feel like he did a great job of holding this thing together for 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Well, his specialty at Warner Brothers was carving out star vehicles for women from novels, basically.
Well, he did King's Row as well, which is another sprawling book.
Right.
But a different kind of story, right? Because this one is so heavily focused on the two stars, whereas King's Row kind of goes all over the place, and it's all interesting. And I was surprised, as you say, it did seem to be gearing us up for tragedy, and right up to the last minute, we're not sure if there is going to be a key death of one of our players, but there isn't, and the little family emerges from it stronger and more united than ever, sanctified by marriage.
Maybe my favorite of the scenes between Cooper and Bergman is the one where she is drinking champagne with peaches in it in one of her manic phases as she's about to collapse from physical and emotional exhaustion from putting all of her schemes in motion, from which Angelique explains she will emerge all the more lively, energetic, and schemeful after a couple of days of coma-like sleep, like a vampire. Cooper's reactions to her as she goes through these insane abrupt mood swings, how he just keeps, well, he's constantly threatening to give up on her.
Yeah.
And you can fully understand why. She is a unique being and a difficult one to handle, and he thinks of himself as this completely straightforward, simple person, right? But he does just keep hanging in there. As you say, it's like they, as a temperamental mismatch, they need to balance each other.
The only problem with this movie is the casting of Flora Robson, and it's a huge problem and a major demerit.
But I'm sure it's not the cause of the critics' distaste for it at the time.
No, and it should have been, because they should have been saying this is basically a perfect movie other than that. Maybe the final scene as well, depending on how much you believe it's tongue-in-cheek.
I don't care whether it's tongue-in-cheek. It's nauseating.
Now let's turn our attention to our second feature. Again, the Warner Brothers story. Zachary Scott played a two-timing swine in Danger Signal, veering indecisively between his fiancée, Faye Emerson, and Mona Freeman, her younger and wealthier sister. His indecision resolved itself in a welter of melodramatics from which no one emerged with any credit. Adele Comandini and C. Graham Baker wrote the anemic screenplay from a story by Phyllis Bottome. It was produced by William Jacobs with a cast that included Dick Erdman, Rosemary DeCamp, Bruce Bennett, and John Ridgely, and the director was Robert Florey. On this occasion, he should have chosen to shield his reputation under his pseudonym Florian Roberts.
Can you hand me that book so I can throw it in the garbage? That is infuriating. This guy never has anything good to say. He's the most snide, superior, and negative. He's worse than Bosley Crowther, who also did not like this movie, but was more restrained in his contempt.
I think this movie was amazing.
I think I liked this better than Saratoga Trunk.
Well, I gave this one 4.5 stars and Saratoga Trunk 4 stars.
See? There you go.
It would have been a closer fight without the casting of Flora Robson.
But as a genre exercise, this movie is so unusual that it's absolutely fascinating. And apparently the cast members, such as Rosemary DeCamp as Dr. Jane Silla, felt the same way. Like, she felt the same way about this movie, that it was unusual and interesting.
It's glorious.
This was her favorite role.
I don't doubt it. She's been in much bigger movies than this, but she's usually a doting mother or some other kind of mild-mannered friend of the family, but not like this. Basically, she's playing Van Helsing to Zachary Scott's Dracula.
Sure, or like Clarice Starling to his Hannibal Lecter, except they seem to be reversed. Robert Florey, we mainly know from the unsung, and is mainly known from the unsung or undersung pre-code horror masterpiece, Murders in the Rue Morgue.
He also directed some great Twilight Zone episodes like Perchance to Dream. We've got a lot of Robert Florey on our schedule, actually.
What on earth is Hirshhorn talking about welter of melodramatics? This is a totally restrained movie that's more clinical and analytical in its approach than anything else, with some humor thrown in.
Maybe he was put off by the crazy car ride.
But that was the humor!
I know.
That was the comic relief.
Yeah. Incredibly psychologically probing look at a woman who's been pushed to the point of wanting to kill someone, and it really puts you in her headspace. It's not about Zachary Scott at all. I mean, he's the catalyst.
I think in one of our many, at this point, many film podcast episodes, I have mentioned before one of my old friends who was a film critic, George Tolles, by which I mean film writer, not
a Bosley Crowther.
Not a Crowther. Once said to me, I have no idea if he would stand by this, but I think he is the type who stands by just about anything they've ever said, advisedly or not, that a good director can elevate a mediocre screenplay, but a good screenplay can't elevate mediocre direction. The direction is good in this movie, but the interest is in the screenplay, and I think that at the bottom of the interest of the screenplay is Phyllis Bottome.
Another writer that we've discussed quite often on the podcast, but neither of us haven't read her work.
We've now seen 3 out of 4, and we might have picked it for this reason. We planned the podcast in such detail so far in advance that we don't always remember why we pick movies for the studio series.
We've learned to trust our past selves.
When we were watching it, it was a surprise to see her name come up on the screen. So yeah, so this is our 3rd Bottome adaptation film that we've seen out of 4. The other 2 being Private Worlds, that even more had a psychiatric angle. She was an Adlerian. And Mortal Storm, which is a different side of Phyllis Bottome that does turn out briefly in the screenplay.
The anti-Nazi side.
The anti-Nazi side. Zachary Scott and Faye Emerson were, of course, previously paired in similar roles, in a similar relationship, in The Mask of Demetrius.
Yeah, a great movie.
Which we've done for the podcast.
And this also plays like a version of Mildred Pierce. It's the same year. You've got Zachary Scott and Bruce Bennett playing the same kinds of characters in the life of this protagonist.
Anne Blythe was supposed to play the younger sister.
Oh, well, that would have made it even better.
But she had to drop out.
Oh, what a shame. I mean, Mona Freeman is good.
I feel like Anne Blythe would have thrown it off because there would be too much star quality there.
Maybe. But yeah, that would have made the symmetry even more perfect. But what doesn't happen in Mildred Pierce, like, that movie doesn't really acknowledge, it's certainly there at the margin, Joan Crawford's desire to kill Zachary Scott. But that movie, all of it's about how, no, she wasn't responsible for it. It's Vida, that maniac, spoiled child that is responsible for this murder. In this movie, it's really just all going on in the mind of Faye Emerson. Is she going to kill this man or is she not? There's nothing stopping her from doing it at the end, and she chooses not to.
Unlike Saratoga Trunk, this movie did diverge from the source.
Where she does kill him.
Where probably. She does kill him.
Yeah.
And I think the way it's handled in the screenplay is really clever, actually, because we're set up from the time the psychiatrist kind of separately invites them both to go to the beach cottage. We're set up to feel that, because we know that he's a murderer, no one else knows that. It's never even revealed to them on screen.
No.
We're set up to fear that at the end of the movie there's going to be a mad car race to stop him from killing her. So the twist is quite interesting. Also of note is the fact that this is a very rare movie in all of world cinema, in that there are as many important speaking roles for women as for men. Movies can do this, guys. It can be done. As soon as women, even in like the mid-40s, as soon as women start entering professions at all, it can be done. You can do a 50-50 gender split movie. Nobody's gonna have their heads blow up and fall off.
No, it just makes it better. That's a really good little role for Joyce Compton as the friend at the public stenographer office. I mean, great role for Rosemary DeCamp. She probably deserved a Best Supporting Actress nomination as well for this movie.
And again, just like I wanted to see more of the Bergman and Florence Bates pairing, I wanted to see more of this reverse Hannibal Lecter relationship develop between Rosemary DeCamp and Zachary Scott's characters. Too many interesting relationships going on in this movie. I was just completely tense and fascinated through the whole thing up until the end, because I did predict, you know, that she wasn't going to actually kill him, so that part wasn't so tense.
Well, Rosemary DeCamp tells us, and she seems to have authority when she says it, that no matter what Faye Emerson sets out to do, she won't be able to murder someone.
Well, she tells her to remember that, so it feels like even though there's been no hypnosis, she's trying to instill a post-hypnotic suggestion.
Yeah.
So what have we got here? So in the opening scene, And by the way, if anybody's still on the fence about seeing this B-movie, it is shot by James Wong Howe.
Oh, so and the opening scenes are incredible.
It has filmic qualities.
It absolutely does.
We see this mystery of Zachary Scott's character that he is taking a wedding ring from a woman that says, "Till death do us part," a dead woman.
I didn't realize she was dead when we were watching it at first. I mean, that becomes clear shortly after the scene, but I thought maybe she was just sleeping. Boarding housekeeper is bashing on the door as this is going on. So I guess that is a clue that she's dead. She's not waking up. Anyway, he jumps out the window, twists an ankle, and hobbles off. And we fly into a montage of newspaper headlines and the DA telling the distraught husband of this woman who's dead that, well, they're satisfied that she killed herself, so you go find some evidence. That was great.
There's a suicide note that is in her handwriting, and that's good enough for them, even though he swears she isn't the type.
Yeah, and we find out later that this is part of Zachary Scott's toolbox.
It's his MO.
But I really like John Ridgely's moment there where he's like, I have to get the evidence. What the hell is this?
You're the police.
No, not in this case. It all pays off. I was wondering, are we ever going to see him again? Well, we do. He chases Zachary Scott off a cliff at the end of the movie.
So the whole time that he's seducing Faye Emerson, so he moves in as a boarder into her home with where she lives with her mother, and her sister is away at a sanatorium to clear up a lung, and it's actually a biographical detail from Phyllis Bottome's life. This is the family unit, but we don't get the younger sister right away. We see him closing in on Faye Emerson, but we still don't know exactly what he's done and what he does. He seems to maybe be driving women to suicide or somehow murdering them and getting a suicide note. We don't know. There's so much mystery surrounding his character, and yet we see him, without full knowledge, we see him going to work on this new victim.
For so much of the film, all he's really done is con them out of a room and maybe a few movie tickets, and it seems like very small game.
So she's a freelance typist working in a shared office.
Those scenes at her office are really fun.
There's a professor suitor. Well, she feels like she can't get a man. She's a working girl, quiet, reserved. She wears glasses. She's not flashy. And so her problem is that she's attracting similar men, and the men are not making the moves, as we see with this professor would-be suitor.
Bruce Bennett, who plays Bert in Mildred Pierce.
So what she needs is a very forward seducer.
And that's certainly what she gets. On a fateful day when her mother had hung out a shingle, a room for rent sign. This is during World War II, where there was a housing shortage, and patriotic people were taking in rumors left and right.
Well, sure, it's the era of the more the merrier.
There are so many films from the first half of the 40s that use this as a shortcut to interesting scenarios.
And he has made up a military background.
He steals a veteran's pin. You know, he improvises. He's quick. There's no doubt about that.
I think Zachary Scott's performance is great.
It is.
When he is romancing her, he never... There's an unctuousness to it, but he plays it convincingly as if he's sincere. He doesn't give away how sociopathic he is. In the performance, I mean. You can see how she would buy this.
He fully commits to whatever bit he is engaged in.
Well, that's kind of the sociopathic nature itself, right? As it's manifesting in this character. She says at one point, you don't just write fiction, you live it. And he does seem to believe in what he's doing in the moment that he does it.
That's the secret of his success. And he is a successful writer as well. He's getting his stories published, even though he's pretending he's not.
So I guess one of the things this novel is, of Bottome's, is exploring the character of the writer, right? The writer can be a psychiatrist analyzing their own mind and the human mind, or they can be a make-believer in their lives as in their stories.
Yeah, a dangerous fabulist and a seductive one, because it's always interesting. He has no trouble reeling in all three members of this family that he's living with. He's had a lot of practice. We have no idea how many women he's killed.
So we don't really get an understanding of why he's doing any of this, which is good, because it keeps you intrigued, until he just explains it all to the psychiatrist, to Dr. Silla. Rosemary DeCamp is putting on a European, I guess, German accent. She's set up to be a mother figure to Zachary Scott here, a glamorous mother figure. She's like 4 years older than him.
She always plays a mother.
Well, Well, she's not a mother in this movie, though.
No, I mean, that's why it's so refreshing to see her.
He spills everything to this psychiatrist as soon as she asks. He's only too happy to talk about his complexes, which appear to be that he was in love with his mother, who was a woman of poise and glamour and authority, but blames her for the death of his father. So he seems to be... We never really get the full story in the movie, but it appears that he's seducing these women and making them commit suicide as a way of getting revenge on his mother for causing his father's suicide. Anyway, it's all about this family romance drama that he's been involved in.
But the most amazing thing about the movie, because that's, you know, none of that is unexpected, and Zachary Scott is maybe the best person to play a character like that, but it's all a bait and switch, because the movie is really about Faye Emerson.
Yes.
And how she's going to react to meeting this guy.
Well, it's set up when she finally realizes that he's a sociopath and he has turned her mother and her sister against her. They believe that she only hates him because
sour grapes
spontaneously fallen in love with this little sister, and it has nothing to do with her inheritance. So everyone's been thoroughly gaslit by this guy. She freaks out and she talks to her friend, the psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist spells it out. She corrects Hilda and tells her that the impulse to murder, or does it happen in that scene actually, or does it happen earlier? Maybe it happens in her first scene, in her introduction. At some point she corrects somebody who is talking about criminal psychology and the mind of a murderer, and she says, no, we all have these impulses.
That's the first scene.
Yeah, maybe she says something like that again in their long scene together, where she plants her pre-hypnotic, post-hypnotic suggestion that you're not a murderer in Hilda's mind.
You may have murderous thoughts, but you can't do it. Something strong and moral within you will keep you from actually pulling the trigger or dropping the botulism.
So that is the theme of the movie, right? We see a person who is a murderer and a sociopath, and yes, we think the movie is going to be about him, but it turns out to be, how can an ordinary moral person be turned into a murderer?
I mean, I quickly stopped worrying about Hilda's life. Zachary Scott, if anything, is going to be the victim here, and then it's going to be bad news for her, and everyone's going to feel terrible because her life is ruined. If you kill someone, it doesn't matter why, usually.
Right, as Dr. Scylla says.
That scene where she's waiting in his room with the gun is so incredible.
Especially since her only defense would be he mind-gamed me to death.
Yeah, that's not good enough. If Anne doesn't walk in at just the right minute, it's clear she's gonna blow his head off.
But you can also, even though that is not a defense that would hold up in court, he mind-gamed me to death, when we see what he's actually doing, it's kind of like when we were talking about Rex Harrison's character in The Rake's Progress. When we see that these mind games that he's playing just don't make any sense at all, they make no human sense, you can see how that would make somebody snap and go crazy. Whether they're going to commit suicide or they're going to commit murder or something, because he doesn't make any sense to a normal human being, what he's doing.
He has no respect for women, clearly. And also, he's probably daring someone to just kill him.
Maybe.
I think that's got to be part of it.
We know his full psychological profile.
Yeah, but we don't know the real impact it had on him. Or anyway, I'm extrapolating stuff that's not in there. But I really did feel like he's going through life wondering, okay, when is one of these people going to just kill me? For being the way I am. He's not worried about being caught by the law, really. It's just like, how outrageous do I have to be before someone puts me out of my misery?
But he seems to be pleading for his life at the end.
Well, that's true. That's true.
All that Dr. Scylla says in a very, very modern feminist speech about certain types of men who hate women, right? All she says is that he has spent his life in the pursuit of women, so women are all important to him, right? And that's why he just keeps going from one to the other in this endless pursuit, but at the same time he hates them.
The directorial touches, and of course aided miraculously by James Wong Howe, they come throughout, but I think the scene where she's waiting in the room with the gun is the best directed scene in the whole movie. I mean, it really had me freaking out, wondering what was going to happen there. Of course, the script was there, but it's got to be directed just right to have the impact that it does. She's hiding behind that door with this gun that's been... She found it in his room, and she just keeps thinking about it and thinking about it and thinking, about using it on him. Eventually, she hits upon a much better plan, which is to poison him with botulism.
Well, it's a better plan, except that she's going to be exposed immediately because her would-be boyfriend notices that she's taken it.
Bruce Bennett is playing a stereotypical absent-minded professor through much. I mean, he can't remember anything, but he's right on it when he sees a vial of botulism missing.
Which you would hope.
Well, you would hope, but I wasn't expecting it. I thought... I didn't realize he was going to notice. Did you?
Well, I thought they could play it either way.
I thought she was going to be on her own with this botulism and nobody was going to be aware.
Presumably that happened in the novel. She does it. She goes through with it.
But nobody stops her in this movie.
Trying to.
Yeah, they're trying, but it's not them that stops it because she decides not to use it.
True.
But she gets her revenge anyway by playing out the scene with him as if she had poisoned him.
So the more interesting of the two screenwriters here...
Adele Commandini.
Would seem to be Adele Commandini, who was involved with Three Smart Girls. Very good movie. Deanna Durbin movie. Won the Academy Award for Best Story for that. And also worked on Christmas in Connecticut.
Oh, wow.
She was the co-writer of the screenplay for that. You love that movie, and it's got a professional woman in it.
It does.
And also involved with... Strange Illusion.
Oh, wow.
Which we're going to have to see again. Do we have it on the schedule? Edgar G. Ulmer's little B movie that, you know, has a sort of cult reputation. Based on Hamlet. Some more crazy mother complexes. I don't think they listen to our podcast, but this seems like a movie danger signal for the important cinema club.
No, they probably enjoy it. I don't see how you can't. It's terrific.
They love their Ulmer. So what can we say, the question I keep asking these days to keep us on track with this series, what can we say about Warner Brothers 1945 based on these two movies?
Well, we can certainly say that this is a studio that, despite its man's man reputation, is telling a lot of compelling stories about women.
Sure.
This is the year of Mildred Pierce, and we're not even doing that one. And we've seen two utterly unique portrayals of women at the center of the narratives.
I already said when we did the Ethan Mordden episode, his book on the studios, and we picked Warner Brothers, both of us, as our favorite studio. I already said that 50% of the reason for my picking it is their women's pictures, particularly of the 1940s. They make the best...
noirish women's pictures.
They make the best women's pictures, period, of any studio.
A lot of that, I think, is how Wallace... he was backing stories like that. He would do it again later on when he leaves and goes to Paramount and gets his own unit. You know, that's where you get The Strange Love of Martha Ivers and a lot of movies that he did with Dieterle. That's got to be a big part of it. Zachary Scott and Faye Emerson are really key parts of the Warner Brothers team in the mid-1940s. Faye Emerson would have probably been even more prominent if she hadn't married the president's son and kind of slowed down for a while.
Well, apparently that marriage really slowed down this production. It was heavily interfering with the production of this movie. So in the TCM article on Danger Signal, it says that the reason Robert Florey never got out of the Bees is because he was just too good at them. He was just too good at churning out quality money-making bees.
Yeah, I believe it. Shall we turn our attention to Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto?
Let's.
So Design for Living was the capper on the Lubitsch retrospective at the TIFF Cinematheque. How did you feel about it on this viewing?
I think this is only my second viewing of it. It's never been one of my favorites.
No, me neither.
I want to like it. I want to like a movie that's about a woman being in love with two men. And, you know, that's okay according to the movie, although it creates obstacles in the plot. But it feels like a huge step back from Trouble in Paradise in terms of filmmaking technique. It feels stiff, stagey, wooden.
I don't know if it feels stiff, stagey, and wooden, but it certainly...
It does.
It's less compelling than Trouble in Paradise.
I mean, that movie tells its story through visual tricks, through editing. The wit is in the editing. Here, it's just a kind of a play with dialogue, and the dialogue's not good enough.
One thing that it gets lauded for all the time is being some kind of breakthrough story about a ménage à trois, but it's really not.
Well, okay, so Guy Maddin's video introduction was very useful in that regard because it made me zero in on the aspect of the film that, like, he called it a love triangle film, like Trouble in Paradise. this is the first time I realized that that's what it is. It's about the pain of this situation, because none of them can just accept the idea of this being an open relationship. And even if they did, it's not like these jealousy problems are going to disappear.
I guess one thing you can say for it is that it's not condemning anything on moral grounds.
But definitely not.
But it is condemning, or it's saying it's not going to work if you actually have sex. So they're committing to lives of celibacy at the end of the movie. That's what this...
Well, we know it's not going to work again.
Probably not, but they can't have a real ménage à trois. They can't have a real polyamorous situation, because as soon as sex happens between two of the people, the other one's going to freak out and it's all going to break down again.
That's what the whole movie is.
That's what it dramatizes. So that's not...
We know that Lubitsch is obsessed with infidelity. It turns up again and again and again in his movies, right? And sometimes it's just for laughs, and sometimes it's really painful, and sometimes it's a bit of both.
In this one, it kind of is both, because you have Frederick March registering real pain when he finds out about the consummation of the couplehood, when he's left them behind to go to produce his play. But it's not Matichek levels of despair.
No, these people are too sophisticated for that, but they're not sophisticated enough to be able to handle polyamory.
No.
I don't know if that takes sophistication, but it takes something, and they don't have it. You hear stories all the time about real life polyamory is just this happening all the time.
For the most part, it does seem to degenerate into this, although willing to hear stories to the contrary.
I was listening to a podcast on it out of curiosity. You can have very stable situations over a very long period of time, but then depending how many people are involved, you know, satellite situations can get really messy. Anyhow, the one thing I will say for the movie is that Miriam Hopkins is incredibly sexy in it.
She's wonderful. Unfortunately, I am no gentleman. She and Lubitsch get the most out of that line.
And as Madden said, she's not sexy as a sex object. She's sexy because she's really horny throughout this movie.
Yeah, I quite agree. We'll close the book on Lubitsch there, but they certainly didn't show all of his films. Maybe we'll get a Lubitsch retrospective part 2 someday. If we do, we will be there to see them. We do have 8 movies booked for January 2024 at the Cinematheque.
I think I've seen none of them except for The Hustler.
I think it's going to be an interesting month, unless we get waylaid by sickness or work requirements or something.
Sports movies.
And next week on the podcast, we return to the Actorist Oeuvre Review. It's Lily Palmer, part 7. This is one of those episodes where we had two, but then another one turned up that fits in chronologically that I did not believe was available. So we're doing 3 movies next week. My Girl Tisa, No Minor Vices, and Hans Le Marin. We'll see you then.